eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Well, good morning. Welcome. It's a beautiful day at Webb Baptist Church. We're so glad you're here. If you're visiting with us today, we'll have you know you're not our visitors. You are honored guests. We do have some white cards on the back of the pew in front of you. If you feel so led to fill that out and drop it in the offering plate when it comes by, we ask you for very minimal information. We're not trying to get your whole life story or get in your business. We just want to shoot you a letter and let you know that we're glad you're here today and to welcome you back at any time in the future. If you haven't noticed, we're without our fearless leader today. He is sick and can't talk, so I'm sure that's great for Miss Jan. Just kidding, Miss Jan. We know he's so sad that he can't be here today, but he's here with us in spirit. And we thank you for Sean for stepping up to fill that spot today. So be in prayer for Brother Danny that he recovers quickly. And also let's be in prayer for Sean as he leads us with the words God's given him today. And let's just have a quick time of prayer. And I'll turn the service back over to Brother Tim and we'll get on with our business. Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful, beautiful day. God, thank you so much for being such an amazing God and being such a good, good Father, Lord, who loves us and protects us and helps us through in our times of need. And Lord, we just thank you so much for your love, and we thank you for the blessing that we have to gather in your house to worship you. Lord, we pray for Brother Danny as he's not with us today. We just pray for his quick recovery so that he can get back to doing what he loves and what he's called to do. And God, we thank you so much for Brother Sean for stepping up today. And we pray your blessing upon him and your anointing upon the words that you've given him to say today. Lord, we know that you have something special in store for us. And God, pray for Brother Tim as he leads us in song. Lord, just let us praise you with our actions. Let us praise you with our words. God, forgive us where we fail you. And just move in a mighty way today, Lord. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Kevin. Doesn't Kevin do a great job?
I tell you. Let's stand together and welcome each other.
We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of God.
Sacrifice.
sacrifices of joy.
Well, amen. Let's continue on with our time of worship together with a wonderful old hymn, 626, The Lily of the Valley.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need is friends that make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's
be seated.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wanda, that was beautiful and very worshipful piano playing right there. I'm coming up again to advertise and remind y'all we have the next discipleship class that Brother Danny and I trade out teaching coming up next Sunday afternoon at 4. We're going to meet down here off of the Welcome Center in one of those classrooms, and it is The Call. We're getting pretty deep, so it says Counting the Cost of Following Christ is kind of the theme for this one. So we're getting serious in the discipleship journey with this. It's really good. The first lesson, we're looking to Jesus and how he began his ministry, his early ministry. So it's really good. I hope that all of y'all would come out. Again, that's next Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock down there in one of those classrooms off the Welcome Center.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Well, as you can clearly see, I am not Danny Summerlin. I have a lot less hair and a lot more, shall we say, padding. That's what we'll call it. We are glad to have you with us this morning. Y'all pray for Brother Danny. He called me earlier this week, and I mean, he could barely above a whisper on the other end of the line, and John, I don't know if I can make it. You have something ready? I said, Brother Danny, don't you worry about that. We got it covered. And but y'all pray for him, because I know a preacher on Sunday morning not being able to preach, that's got to be eating at him, right? But, you know, and I've been right where he's sitting right now, kind of worried. I'm sick. I had to call an emergency fill-in preacher. Is he going to say something wrong? Is he going to offend somebody? Is he going to bring in snakes or anything? Y'all can rest assured. Just put your mind at ease. I only know how to preach about Jesus. As Spurgeon used to say it, preach Jesus or go home. Amen. So we're going to preach about Jesus this morning. If you have your Bibles with you, I invite you to turn with me, please, to the Gospel of Luke. Gospel of Luke chapter 5. We're going to look at a pretty familiar passage. If you've been in church life for any length of time, you've read this passage. We're going to look at it and we're going to see some things. Maybe take a look at it in a new way. As you're turning there, Luke chapter 5. In studying this this week, trying to put this together, I was looking at some statistics, and we've got some interesting things happening across this country. I don't know if you're aware, but the church in America has been on the decline for years. Matter of fact, between 2019 and 2020, the Southern Baptist Convention lost in 1 year 2% of its membership. Church is on the decline, but conversely, on the other side of the coin, there's never been a greater interest across this country in things spiritual. Never been a greater interest in God. This past fall, Auburn University, they had a Christian concert come in, and a revival broke out, folks. Hundreds of students ended up getting baptized in the lake there at Auburn. And I believe I was reading the campus newspaper was writing about it and said the spirit was so warm in that place, nobody wanted to go home. Matter of fact, I think they said security had to come and turn the lights out before anybody would want to leave. And that's happening across our nation, across our college campuses and our schools. Revival just spontaneously breaking out. So there's an interest in things spiritual. There's an interest in God, but our church membership is declining. So there's a disconnect there. And we're going to look at that and maybe look at a fresh approach maybe of how we can reach people for Jesus as we start out this new year. So if you have your Bibles, I invite you, and if you're able, invite you to stand with me out of reverence for the reading of God's Word. We're looking in Luke chapter 5. And we're going to start in verse 17. 17 through 26. Now it happened on a certain day as he was teaching that there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by, who had come out of every town of Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Then behold, men brought on a bed a man who was paralyzed, whom they sought to bring in and lay before him. And when they could not find how they might bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling into the midst before Jesus. When he saw their faith, he said to him, Man, your sins are forgiven. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, Who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sin but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answered and said to them, Why are you reasoning in your hearts? Which is easier to say, Your sins are forgiven you, or to say, Rise up and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. Immediately he rose up before them, took up what he had been lying on, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God, and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today. Father God, bless the reading of your word. Bless our time here together. May your Holy Spirit move in and amongst us. We give you this time now in the precious and holy name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm reading this passage and all I'm thinking is how cool it must have been to have friends so committed. Now, the scripture's not specific of how many friends there were. But I imagine it in my mind, if there's a paralyzed man on a mat, maybe he's a square mat, so we put a guy at each corner of the mat, so maybe four friends, and they come and they carry their friend to Jesus. What's happening here? Jesus is at the height of his ministry. And he's gone through villages and towns, and he's teaching, he's preaching, and he's healing. And he finds himself in this little community, and he's been invited into a home, and he's healing people. And there's a huge crowd that's gathered around. Throngs of people coming to see this man Jesus, to hear his words, and to see him heal those who are sick. And then you have these four friends. They want to get their friend to Jesus. They said to themselves, they knew in their minds, if we can just get him to Jesus, Jesus can heal him. We got to get him to Jesus. So you can imagine, they pick up his mat, they carry him down the street, they get to the house. They try to go through the front door, but there's so many people crammed in the places. The house is completely full, shoulder to shoulder, standing room only, like a Taylor Swift concert. There's Swifties everywhere, amen? Just everywhere. They're crowded in the house. They're jamming the doors so they can crane their necks in. They're looking through the windows. Everybody jammed in to try to see this man Jesus. So they go to the front door, can't get in. Well, maybe there's a back door. So they go around, carry him around to the back. Same story. Swifties everywhere, just packed in. Okay, what about the windows? Maybe we can get them through a window. And they look, and oh no, everybody's craning in looking to see Jesus. Can't get in through the windows. Now, if I'm honest with y'all, and I got to be honest because I'm in the pulpit this Sunday morning, so I better be, right? If I'm honest with you, if it's me, right about that point, I'm saying, I'm sorry, buddy. We did the best we could. But I guess we didn't get our fast pass or our VIP backstage pass in time. We're just not going to be able to make it happen today. But what about these guys? What did they do? Were they deterred? No. Just imagine. I imagine like it's like a Mel Brooks movie. They're standing there. What do we do? What do we do? And one of them looks up and says, hey, guys, let's go up there. Now, these homes, these houses had like thatched roofs. So they find a way, manhandle this guy on his mat up to the roof of the house. They get up there, and they start peeling a hole in the roof. I imagine the homeowner was really loving that. And then picture in your mind, Jesus is sitting there. He's got a huge crowd in front of him. He's teaching, he's preaching. And all of a sudden, here comes a guy. Right in front of him. They lower him down by that mat right to Jesus' feet. There are four C's that you can see in this passage. Four C's that these friends carried out in their lives. So they just had to get their friend to Jesus. If I can just get you to Jesus, it's going to make all the difference. The first C, they had compassion. They heard Jesus was coming. They heard he was in town. Everybody wanted to see what this man Jesus was all about. Their first thought was their friend. They had compassion. The Bible doesn't go into detail how long this man had been paralyzed, how long he'd even been friends with these folks. They may have just met 7-Eleven earlier that day. Who knows? But they had compassion. And their first thought, we got to get him to Jesus. Their first thought wasn't, oh, I better make sure I got my robe pressed and my nails done and my hair all did up. Because Jesus is coming. No, they said, that's our friend. And we know who has the answer for him. We know who has the solution to his problem. They had compassion. The second C, they had confidence. They had confidence both in themselves and in the power of God. Amen. They had confidence. They just knew Jesus could heal their friend. There wasn't any question. Yes, Jesus can do it. I wonder how many things they tried. How many things this man had tried to be healed. Had he been to a medicine person? Had he been to a physician? We don't know. I just wonder what all they have been through But they knew Jesus was the answer. Amen, Jesus is the answer. They had confidence in the power of God, but they also had confidence in themselves. We can do this. This is a monumental task, but we can do it. Have you ever been that way in your life, that place in your life where you just had that confidence that, well, I don't know how we're going to do it, but we're going to do it? That's these guys. They had confidence. They were compassionate. The third C, they were creative. Now, the homeowner in this passage maybe would call it something else, maybe vandalism, breaking and entering, I don't know, you just name it. I'm sure the insurance company was loving it too. But they were creative. When they were faced with an obstacle, they didn't do like I would have done and just say, well, I'm sorry, we tried. They found a creative way to what? Get their friend to Jesus. Isn't that what we're trying to do in our lives, in our church, in our country? If we can just get people to Jesus, Jesus has the answer, folks. If we could just get them to Jesus. So they were creative. They were compassionate. They were confident. And here's your fourth C. They were committed. There wasn't anything that was going to stop them. We're going to get this done. They brought their friend. They come to the front door. Sorry, you can't get in this way. It's blocked. Maybe there's a big bouncer standing there. I don't know. We can't get in through the front door. Okay, we'll go to the back door. Nope, can't get there. Okay, we'll go to the window. Nope, no windows. Okay, we're going to get this guy to Jesus. What are we going to do, guys? What are we going to do, fellas? Here we go. Let's go to the roof. Now imagine, y'all. Let's put this in today's perspective. What if I'm right here preaching, y'all, and a hole opens up in the roof? A building committee's going to have a fit. Amen? Just imagine, they were committed. So they had compassion, they were confident, they had to be creative, and yet they were committed. Nothing was going to dissuade them. They were going to get it done. So if you look at this passage, let's take a step back. And let's look at you and me today. The world has never had a greater need for the good news. Don't you think so? That's that old song used to say, if we ever needed the Lord before, what? We sure do need him now. The world has never had a greater need for the good news. I was putting together some notes for a Bible study I was doing with the youth a couple weeks ago. Let me go ahead and put my shameless plug in. I am the student minister, and we have a youth program, grades 7 through 12, every Wednesday night. We have a meeting, and we invite any students in this area, in this community that want to come. We'd love to have you. We start about 6 o'clock over in the fellowship hall with supper, and then we go up to the youth room, and we have a real good time. We have some games. We have some discussion. It's a real good time, so we invite you to be a part of that. But I was putting notes together for that youth Bible study, and I found this survey. It suggested that more Americans today believe that aliens have visited the earth than believe in the God of the Bible. Now, here's a caveat. When surveyed, about 90% of Americans say they believe in God. But shockingly, only a little over half of those say they believe in the God of the Bible. 65 to 68% of survey respondents said, I believe the little green men are flying in their flying saucers, landing in Roswell, New Mexico, to come see us, but only a little over 50% believe in the God of the Bible. That's the world we're in today, folks. We have a whole generation growing up in a society this may be second, third, maybe even fourth generation, unchurched. We live in a society where campus lockdowns, active shooter drills, that's common. Now, those of you that are in education, you know active shooter drills, campus lockdowns, that has a psychological impact on our students, folks. That has a psychological impact on us. Another thing, there's a pervasive opioid epidemic across this country. We don't really talk about that. We certainly don't talk about it enough. We don't talk about it a lot at all. But it's all over the country. Ask anybody in EMS, emergency medicine, law enforcement. This country is eaten up with an opioid epidemic. Folks are trying to fill an emptiness in their life with anything, literally in a lot of cases, anything they can get their hands on. What's the answer? Jesus is the answer. So maybe when we think about this world that we're in today, maybe we can apply those four C's to maybe address this disconnect between those that are seeking so hard for something to hold on to and the decline in church membership. Have compassion. Be confident. Be confident in yourself, but also be confident in your God. And remember this, we don't do the saving. Jesus does. And use that creativity. Now in 2024, we have technology that makes pretty much the only limit is your imagination, right? And this church is really great about that. They do some creative things. We have YouTube and Facebook and YouTube Shorts. And I mean, this service you will be able to find online. It's amazing, the creativity, social media, but also the creativity in meeting those needs and getting people to Jesus. Think about our last church. I'm going to tell on Brother Danny and Jan here a little bit. The community full of children, young people. We got to get them to church. Well, mom and dad either didn't want to come to church with them or weren't able to come to church with them. And Danny and Jan said, well, that's no problem. We got a church van right here. We'll run that church van. We're going to be creative, whatever it takes. And I'm going to tell you what, folks, that took a lot. It was a commitment. Brother Danny is putting together a prayer meeting, keeping up with their prayer list, doing the visitation. And then in the middle of all that, he and Jan get in that bus, run through the community, pick up these kids, take them to church, feed them, tell them about Jesus. And then after all is all said and done, cart them back home. And then come back and go to choir practice. That's creative. That's showing those four C's. They were compassionate. They have compassion for those children. They were confident. They knew if I could just get them to Jesus. Now, I want y'all to think. Who in your life do you need to get to Jesus? Or maybe you're here today and maybe somebody's used those four C's to get you where you're sitting right now. They were confident, they were committed, compassionate, and creative. You don't have a ride to church? That's okay, I'll be there to pick you up. You don't have any food in the house? That's all right. Come to before Sunday school, we'll have breakfast. After church, I'll take you to lunch. We'll go to McDonald's. That's about all I can afford. Something interesting in this passage, if you're not careful, you'll skip right over it. If you look in verse 20, as they lowered this guy down through the ceiling, Jesus sees this whole scene play out in front of him. I imagine he was just loving it. I could just see Jesus with a big old smile on his face, grinning ear to ear. Well, these guys are awesome. And what does it say in verse 20? When Jesus saw their faith, he turned to the man and said, son, your sins are forgiven. Now think about that, believer. Maybe you've been coming to church your whole life. And you don't know the impact that you've had. But Jesus does, and he's seeing your faith. I wonder how many people have been reached, had their sins forgiven, come to Jesus through your faith. So we can use those four C's in our lives, can't we? We can be compassionate. Instead of turning the other way, we can find the compassion. We've got the answer, right? We live in a world, folks, that is upside down. Topsy-turvy. I don't understand it. And I'm not all that old, relatively speaking. World's upside down. We're sitting here, we've got the solution. And people need the Lord. You remember that old song? Was that Steve Green? People need the Lord. Y'all remember that song? When will we realize people need the Lord? So, I promised we would get done a little bit early today, and I've got 3-4 clocks up here. We're doing good. I want to open this up to an invitation. Here's our invitation this morning. It's an invitation for all of us. Everybody here. In just a couple minutes, Tim's going to come on, he's going to play. We have some music going. For believers this morning, I'm going to ask you to ask the Lord to put a name on your heart. Put that name on your heart. Somebody that you know you need to get to Jesus. Somebody you know needs Jesus in their life. And I would say go so far as to write it down in the margin of your bulletin. Put that name on your heart. Some of you might already have that name in your head right now. We're going to open up the invitation and the altar is going to be open. And I'm going to invite believers, come on down. Lift those people up to God. Remember, it's not us that does the saving, it's Jesus. But how will they know if they never hear? Ask God, ask the Lord to put that name on your heart. And when we come to our invitation, I invite you to come down, kneel down here and pray. Or pray wherever you're at in the pews. Write that name down in your heart. Write it down in the margin of your bulletin. And look at those four C's. How can I be used of God to reach these people for Jesus? Understand that. Jesus didn't need all these theatrics, did he? But he invites us as his followers to join him in ministry. God doesn't need us, but he wants to include us. The blessing from that, it goes both ways. That person is blessed that you reach out to, but you are also blessed. It is a blessing to bless. So believers, when we come to this invitation, I ask you to do that. Just pray, God, put a name on my heart. One name, that's all I'm asking. Just one. If you got more names, write them down too, but just one. And then we'll open up the altar. For others, maybe you're here today and you're not real sure where you stand with this man Jesus. Maybe you've been coming to church for years but never had that one-on-one encounter with Jesus Christ. Maybe Sunday morning comes and you lean on that pew in front of you with the white knuckles. Oh, what do people think? I've been coming to this church forever. I don't know if I know Jesus. What are they going to say? Let me tell you what. This is Webb Baptist Church. You'll never find a more loving and accepting body of believers anywhere, folks. You know what we're going to do? We're going to celebrate with you. That's what we're going to do. We're going to say, praise God. Amen. Or maybe today you're here because someone in your life used those four C's and was willing to do whatever it took to get you to Jesus. Well, friend, today can be the day of salvation. Today, you can know with no uncertainty where you stand with God. I'm going to come up front while the music's playing. Any deacons or other ministers that want to come up front, if you want to come talk to us. We'll pray with you. If you need Jesus in your heart, today is the day. Today can be the day of salvation for you, folks. That's it. Have compassion. Have confidence in what your God can do. You say, but oh, this person that I'm thinking about, there's so much going on in their life. You just don't know. I don't know that God can do it. God can. Yes, He can. Be creative. You need a ride to church. You're hungry. You ain't got no groceries in your refrigerator. Y'all, after the holidays, I clean out the refrigerator. Don't come look at my refrigerator, okay? You'll be like trying to take a love offering or something. But I promise, it's just, I got on a cleaning kick and it's just not pretty. They need a ride. They need to be fed. They need something. Don't take no for an answer. Be committed. Be confident. Be creative. And have that compassion. So I'm going to ask Brother Tim to come. I'm going to be up front. Our invitation is open. Ask God to lead you to somebody. Put that name on your heart. Write it down. Ask God where you stand. Stand with us. Lord, just...